Hello, 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 saints, and those who would like to become or don't know that they are. I hope that you've had a productive and blessed day and that you're having a wonderful evening. I'm a little late today, and the reason why I'm a little late is because I had some things to do, but not only that, but I was going over. Actually, I slept in this morning. If you look at yesterday's video, which was the 9th of August, you will see I look exhausted and tired, and I was. It was a long day in church, and there was a lot of stuff going on, which was wonderful, but I had some things I needed to pray about. And then I had to do an annotated bibliography, and for some reason, when I went out, left church and stayed in another city and went to my office over there, my notes had totally disappeared. So I had to completely redo the paper. With God's grace, I was able to get through it. And what's interesting is when you do an annotated bibliography, you have to get some information, and there were three books. And the three books that I was trying to do, the one book would not come on my Kindle. It kept jumping off. So I had to go to a couple other books that I wasn't familiar with, which was good. I got a chance to read some of the prefaces of them. I haven't gotten a grade back yet because I haven't looked. I haven't had time to look. I had to spend some time with my husband, which is really a good thing. The one thing that I got out of today, though, is something changed for me on August 4th and brought me back to the days when I first was asked to minister. And my lifestyle had changed over the years. And when I came into the West Coast, it was completely different. And the people were different. The opportunities were different. And I could not get my grounding. And it's almost as if the Lord sat me down for, let's see, 2020. So 30 years, 10 years less than Moses. And I can honestly tell you, even though I've gone to church, I have felt like I was in Egypt. And August the 4th, whether you believe it or not, in the spiritual realm, I saw my guardian angel, or the angel that's assigned to me. They had their arms up like this. And I was heading in someplace, and they shook their head. You'll go in alone. And I thought, what? Your protection will not be on you if you go in that place again. God wants you to come out of Egypt. Now, what that means to me, I am not going to go into it with you. But Moses spent 40 years in Midian. And when he was confronted with the burning bush, he had to go back into Egypt on assignment, and he went back a few times to tell Pharaoh to let God's people go. And finally, all the people with their animals and their children and everything came marching out of Egypt. Here's the problem. Moses had 40 years in which to get rid of Egypt out of him. And what I am seeing spiritually today is that when Moses brought the children out of Egypt, because Moses had to stay in Midian outside of Egypt for 40 years, the people that had Egypt in them had to stay in the wilderness 40 years. I've never heard this brought out before. It's just a thought that I have, but they ended up, what would have taken them, I believe, 40 days to get to the promised land, which wouldn't have done them a bit of good because they would have still had Egyptian mindset in their eyes. So when God brought me back to the West Coast, I still had East Coast mindset in my heart. And I was trying to make the West Coast be like the East Coast, and they don't minister the same. They didn't know what to do with the Jesus in me that I wanted to bring to ministry. And so God had to let me literally sit in what I consider right now Midian for 30 years to get East Coast mentality out of me to see what was really going on in the East Coast. On August 4th, or a couple days before August 4th, was that Sunday, which was, well, you figure it out. The 4th was Tuesday, I believe. The 3rd was Monday, so Sunday would have been the 2nd. On that Sunday, a young man from our church said, "Oh, so-and-so's preaching now." Well, I remembered the preacher because I had met them, but I had met them with Miriam Heldman. And my husband was clearing out our shop, and he handed me a Miriam Heldman tape. I went, "Oh, wow, that's from, I think it was J Street over in D.C. where I used to go to her services. And I used to minister over there in a worship team." And then William Branham, who I had bought all of the tapes and listened to for years because of Pat Robinson, he wanted us to listen to William Branham, who was a great prophet of God. This was a man who knew things before he went into your house or into the meeting. He had names. He knew who your children were. Great prophet of the Lord. Pretty dull speaker, though, because when I would listen to his tapes, I'd go, "I don't understand how he knows all this stuff." That is the dullest speaker I've ever heard in my life. And you may be thinking that same thing about me. What is this woman doing? Well, if you can't stand it, you don't have to listen to me. And I got a message from a great ministry today, and it says, "Alert! We're going live." And they named all of the TV channels they're going live on. And I thought to myself, you have to pay for that. And then you've got to get money from people mailing money in and stuff. And I sent a note back to them. I said, "You know, we're all live now. That's the only way we're able to talk to anybody. We're all on TV and Facebook, at least Facebook and YouTube is free right now, unless you want to boost and get ads. And that's not what my ministry is about, at least not right now. And I'm not really building a following. What I'm doing is, this is more for me than it is even for you. I have to get used to speaking again and asking for the anointing of the Lord to be on me. One thing that Evie Hill, no, it wasn't Evie Hill. It was actually Robert Slearden made a statement. The great Robert Slearden is back and better than ever. He's 54 years old, and I have a pastor who I'm under, but Robert Slearden is now my second pastor. I submit because the man is a great teacher. He is teaching us about the mistakes that the great ones made and to try to keep us from having the devil have us step into it. But I will tell you, I probably shouldn't have made my video last night. I was so exhausted, and that was one of the things he said. If you're exhausted or tired, go to bed, because that is right when the enemy is going to trip you up. So I don't even remember what I said last night. I knew it had to do with something to do with the prodigals. I'll have to relook at it. But whatever you can get out of it, eat the meat, spit out the bones. That is the word today. So I actually wrote some notes. I decided, because I'm a rabbit trail person, it's a good thing for me to write some notes to try to stay on track. I do know that the Lord has work for the prodigals to do. In the 70s, there was a Jesus movement. And in the Jesus movement, a whole bunch of people came in people that set up Calvary. I think it was Chuck Smith. And then you had this one and that one, very popular preachers you'd know today who've been ministering for 40 years. So again, we come up with this 40-year thing. Getting back to my wilderness experience, which is what I believe God did when he put me into the state of Washington, which is the most unchurched state. I talked to a woman today as I was going out of the store and I had something. I said, well, are you a Christian? She goes, well, I believe in God. Well, so does the devil. I mean, I didn't want to be mean. And I said, oh, okay. And she goes, I even go to church sometimes. And I thought, well, okay, you can sit in a garage, but it still doesn't make you a car. But I wasn't insulting. I didn't say a thing to her. And I said, she asked me a couple other questions. And she said something about this and that. I said, well, I said, you do know about the rapture, don't you? She goes, well, I think Jesus is coming back. I said, not before he takes the church out. And I was allowed, God gave me just a minute to explain to her who the church is. It's the church that believes in Jesus Christ. It's not because you attend church. It's because you have Jesus in your heart and you've given him his heart, and it is a lifestyle. Going to church once in a while is not a lifestyle. And if you have a minister in your church that is not living a lifestyle, and they're just coming in to give you a show, then you may have a problem. They come in, they do the same thing. And what Robert Slearden made a statement today, and I have seen this true, Jesus would like to attend some of our services. Would you believe that some churches don't want him in there? And if he came in, they wouldn't know what to do with him. If the Holy Spirit showed up and wanted to do a miracle, the preachers have not been taught, the ministers, especially the young ones, have not been taught what to do when the Holy Spirit shows up. A lot of them will go, well, that was wonderful, and they'll just go up there and start giving their talk, probably not even out of the Bible sometimes. Now, I'm not taking a swat at church, but we need to get back to the anointing in the church. We need to quit the showmanship. The Holy Spirit doesn't need us, not one bit, other than to have a lifestyle, show up, and let him do what he wants to do. We worship him in spirit and truth. And that's what we want, and that's what we need to get back to. And every preacher has a different type of anointing. John Osteen, who is Joel Osteen's dad, had a cup running over way to talk. He didn't have any notes. He knew his Bible backwards and forwards, and the Holy Spirit spoke through him just fine. And he had one of the biggest churches back in the day of anybody's. Now, Joel Osteen, according to what I'm hearing now, is an exhorter. And Joel Osteen, I've heard people taking shots at him or about him for a while now. And I was kind of going along with them because I was immature, but we need to grow up. Not everybody has the same gifting. It's one person plants a seed, and then another person waters it, and another person grows it. And this is the issue. I think he got on to Oprah Winfrey, and Oprah Winfrey made the statement, oh, don't you agree? There's many roads to God. And Osteen actually said, if we look at the transcript, there are many ways to Jesus to get to God. That's a whole different ball game. So according to what I'm hearing from people who have wisdom and who are mature Christians, Joel Osteen is a church where you've got, if you've had somebody wounded, hurt, that doesn't want to go in and be preached at or told they're going to go to hell because they made a mistake, that might be a good church to look at if you're over there in the Houston area. I think it's the Houston area. I said I would never give church names out loud, but I think that might be a good church to go to. Embassy Church down in Orlando, Florida, through Robert Slurden, I will also commend. There's one other church down there in the area I'm not so sure about. So I'm going to keep my mouth shut. I know a couple churches over here where I am, a couple here, a couple up north, that I would trust a Christian to go to where they're going to get fed. The one thing you want to see is expository preaching. Word upon word, precept upon precept, which we had at our church on Sunday, and I about fell out of my chair. It was so wonderful. I knew I was in the right place. I just couldn't wait to get to that altar to minister and also to repent. We need to be able to repent on a daily basis if we know that we are just going the wrong direction. And then the enemy is the devil, bottom line. And he is sent there to destroy, kill, and do anything he possibly can to disrupt. If he can't get you into hell, he's going to give you hell here on earth. Okay? It doesn't mean you're not a Christian. It just means he's going to disrupt your life. You got to know the word and how to say the word to him and tell him to get lost. And the only thing that's going to do it is the word of God. We are more than conquerors. Jesus is our healer. He took his stripes to heal our infirmities. And on and on and on and on. But the word today was, let me get back here on track. Christians like me keep saying the rapture could come soon. But what if it didn't come for another 20 years? Wouldn't that mean that there's room for the prodigals to come back? And the ones especially that had a call on their life that dropped it down through disillusionment can pick that mantle back up and take and get in to help with the ones that have been ministering for 40 years and be a help and keep bringing in the sheep. And the scripture I have, or the teaching I have to back this up with, the Lord kind of spoke to me this morning. Our pastor says, why would God want us, or one pastor says, why would God want his bride all beat up before taking up the church or the bride? Well, if the bride has already gone through some things, but still alive, because the bride represents the church, she's not being beat up. She's being protected. It's when that protection comes off that I believe God will take the church up. And I believe that John in chapter 4 of Revelation represents the church when the Holy Spirit says, come up. Because then he's looking down and he's being shown all the things that are going to happen, the same as you're going to read in Daniel. So you need to do some studying. You don't have to study to keep up with me. I will try to bring things in. I'm still speaking to the congregation. I'm not speaking to the pastors. But your pastors need help. A good ministry has to have other pastoral staff. Now, if those can be ministers, teachers, help with the children. But they need mature staff, and the better the pastor, the less staff he's going to need. But if he doesn't, and it depends on how large the congregation is. Congregations could get really large. What I'm seeing, it's because I'm hearing things, I'm seeing a third wave of awakening coming. And who is it that's going to minister to these people in this third wave? The other thing is, God's going to take some pastors out of the pulpit that are tired and weary and the anointing is just not on them anymore. That doesn't mean they're not going to go to heaven. It's just they're tired. The anointing is just, if the Holy Spirit would show up, they actually would not. They're not giving altar calls because they assume everybody in their congregation is going to heaven. That is not true. we've got a lot of people sitting in that are wounded, still sitting in the congregation. They're going to church just to feel better. Okay? So then you're going to say, well, Sister Pamela, and by the way, my name's Pamela Gunderson. You can call me Sister Pamela. That I prefer. Well, if I come back in and I do pick up the gauntlet or whatever it is you pick up, the torch, these people before me already have 40 years of wonderfulness, like Billy Graham and Evie Hill, John Osteen, Catherine Kuhlman. They all have all this reputation and they have all these rewards coming from. What would I get? I mean, I might do it, but I'm in too late. I'm late. So what scripture might that apply to? Okay, well, let me read you what one here. Matthew 20, 1 through 16. Is it okay if I read this to you? Matter of fact, I'm going to put it up. No, I'm going to read it right from, this is Jimmy Swaggart's Expositor Study Bible, giant print, because I need giant print. And forgive me bowing my head, but I have a big Bible. I could read it online, but I'm going to do it from this one because there's some information that's really good. The Parable of the Laborers, and it's A.D. 33, chapter 20 of Matthew. For the kingdom of heaven is likened to a man who is an householder, which went out early in the morning to hire laborers into his vineyard. This is a parable. Jesus spoke in parables to make a point, and also to hide some things from the Pharisees. And when he had agreed with the laborers for a penny a day, which is almost $40 a day in our present money, he sent them into his vineyard. And he went out about the third hour, which would be about 9 a.m. in the morning, and saw others standing idle in the marketplace. That might be a prodigal, you think? You're not ministering, you're not going to church. You're not even sure God loves you anymore. But you're standing in the marketplace and you're idle. You have time to do something. And the man said unto them, go ye also into the vineyard, and whatsoever is right, I will give you. And they went their way. They left the amount of payment up to the householder. Whatever it was, at least they're getting paid something for doing something. Again, the householder went out about the sixth and ninth hour, which was 12 o'clock noon and 3 p.m. in the afternoon, and did likewise. And about the 11th hour, which is 5 o'clock in the afternoon, he went out and found others standing idle and said unto them, why stand you here all day idle? They said unto him, because no man has hired us. He said unto them, go ye also into the vineyard, and whatsoever is right, that shall ye receive. They as well took him at his word. So when evening was come, now remember, he's already gone out at 5 o'clock and it's only 1 hour later, about 6 p.m. The Lord of the vineyard said unto his steward, call the laborers and give them their hire, beginning from the last unto the first. The ones hired last were to be paid first, and the ones hired first being paid last. Is this starting to make sense to you? Verse 9, and when they came who were hired about the 11th hour, they received every man a penny. That was about $40 for the 1 hour's work. But when the first came, the first ones hired, they supposed that they were going to receive more. And they likewise received every man a penny, $40. Now remember, they've been out there for about 8 hours. When the last ones came in, they were out in there for about an hour. And the ones that came at noon were in there about 3 hours. Verse 11, and when they had received it, they murmured against the good man of the house, saying, These last have worked but 1 hour, and you have made them equal unto us, which have borne the burden and heat of the day. But the good man answered one of them and said, Friend, I do you no wrong. Did not you agree with me for a penny? Take that which is yours. This is verse 14. Take that which is yours and go your way. I will give unto this last, even as unto you. Our Lord is teaching grace here, which means that we do obtain salvation from him by merit, but not by merit, but as well. Let's see. Which means that we do not obtain salvation from him by merit, by being good, by being the best, by being the most. But as well, it speaks of Israel and the church, and church, although last, will receive just as much as Israel, who was first. And I think it's even more than that. It's about the evangelists and the preachers today in America, and we better get our act together. Sorry about that, but we need to get our act together. Verse 15. Is it not lawful for me to do what I will with mine own? Is your eye evil because I am good? And in red it says, no man has the right to make a claim on God because of merit. It must all be by faith of Christ and the cross. That's Romans 3, 20 through 31, if you want to write that down. And verse 16, so the last shall be first, and the first last. And in red, the church was chosen last, but will be first, because Israel, which was chosen first, rejected the Lord. For many be called, but few chosen. In red, many are called, but only a few choose to heed the call. I'm going by Jimmy Swaggart's red information that he has interpreted, or he feels this is for. Or about his interpretation. I may or may not agree with him, but this is the Bible I'm reading out right now. It is the King James Version. Little thing about Jimmy Swaggart, I certainly do appreciate him more than I did when I lived in Brooklyn. And I'll tell you a little story. I remember everybody was just, oh, Jimmy Swaggart. And I was really newly born again. I had left God. I had prodigaled myself. I was really angry about a few things, but I went back into the church, and all these people were going to go to this Coliseum. Oh, it was Madison Square Garden, I'm pretty sure, where we went, where the great Shambach would go, which I really loved because he was a friend of some of the people I knew, and his daughter would minister with us occasionally. And he's so wonderful. He's so wonderful. He's playing the piano and that. And I remember saying to somebody, what anointing? What are you guys talking about? He's nothing different than anybody else I've seen. As a matter of fact, I don't get it. I think it was very shortly after that he was crying and sobbing on the TV. He had fallen. Well, he did own it. He did own. He made a mistake. And the little insight today from Robert Slurden, who I now own as a teacher that I hold in dear respect, gave a little bit of insight, not about Swaggart, but about any man of God who falls. And it's usually a sexual sin. Jimmy Baker, Jim Swaggart, about at the same time. It is to disappoint the congregation and get them to leave and believe God, whatever it is they can blame God for through the person that's fallen. Jimmy has come back, has not gone under covenant with the church. He went ahead and did his own thing, but he has his own TV station now, and he has every bit as anointing as I've seen. And I love his wife. His wife is wonderful. And there's a wonderful video. Let me see if I can find it here. Oh, Common Core. Frances Swaggart. I watch her occasionally with her son. Donnie is wonderful. He's a little brusque So was Wigglesworth. Donnie's brusque, and he doesn't hold any punches. Frances is very sweet, but she has, it's called The Truth About Common Core. And these are things that you're going to be learning through my ministry, because I'm very interested in all this stuff. If you're not, fine, but I am, and I will teach it and I will show it to you. I will occasionally, as I get better at this, be able to put up some sound bites so you can peek in. Some of these things are going on. What my suggestion is, turn off the news. There is nothing new under the sun. We kind of love Tucker. I think everybody loves Tucker Carlson because he's about the only one that's telling the truth about anything, and they're hating him. I've noticed advertising has really fallen down on his shows. There's not as much other than, and then Greta Ingram, I think it is. I think it's Greta, but it's Ingram. She's got so much advertising on there. We love Raymond. Raymond brings a lot of stuff in, but he's just for fun. But let's start listening to some Christian programming and be able to pray for some of these pastors and these ministers. Let's start listening to worship music. Let's start living the lifestyle so that God can bless us and that we can be a blessing to our congregations. Time could be getting short. But what if we have another 20 years and they take away our First Amendment, our Second Amendment? I'm not prophesying and I'm not giving a date, but I thought the Lord spoke a word to me this morning. And I know pretty much what my promise is, and I don't think we're going to get out of it. We're not going through tribulation, don't get me wrong. That's going to be so bad. If you think this is bad, oh my God, I don't think so. But that'll be 7 years of worse than hell. And if you let the devil let you just go around doing things that is not Christian lifestyle, he's going to make hell on earth for you, even though you may not go through tribulation. And I think we have a lot of work to do before God's going to take us out. I'm part of the bride. I don't feel beat up. I'm under his protection. But I'll tell you one thing. My angel said, I'm not going in with you. You want to go in? I'm not going in to protect you. That's pretty serious. I didn't even think it was something, any really real big deal. And then the Lord said, you get serious with me and I'll get serious with you. And all of a sudden, he restored what he had prophesied into my life about ministry 30 years ago. So if you want to get serious with God, but no, you are going to get the same reward for obeying the Lord as Billy Graham, because it says so right here in this word. You're going to get the same reward. And it's not going to be justice that you want, because if God gives you justice, wouldn't you rather have mercy? Justice may have a penalty to it. All your rewards may be all burned up. But mercy is, I see you obeyed me in this. You tried. But justice? Give me mercy, and I'll pull a scripture out for that as soon as I can find it. I'm going to be more scripture-led. Oh, and then the last thing the Lord spoke to me this morning, I slept till noon. 5 hours sleep doesn't do it for me. I was up till 1:30 this morning, making sure I had 6 minutes of video to you all. I promised I'd be here, and I'm here. I promise that anyone that contacts me will get a New Testament. I will mail it out to them. All I need is a mailing address. I have a whole box here just waiting. If you're new or if you're old or whatever it is, you'll get a Bible. And it costs you nothing. Actually, it'll be a blessing to you. It'll be a blessing to me. I want to get rid of these out of my house because they're taking up room. I had two dreams, but the dreams were like I was trying to fall asleep. But I kept dreaming like I was awake. I can't tell you what the dreams were because of the fact that they would implicate people I know, and I don't want anybody to see that on this video because somebody from my church might actually see it. And we have no idea what the devil would love to put together for whatever reason. So anyway, two things that the Lord spoke to me in dreams. Number one, did you hear an audible voice from a person, and what did they say? Try to remember, write it down. Did they represent the Lord? Because the person that spoke to me in the dream asked me, and this I can share with you, in front of some type of a machine, and I remember seeing my grandmother's afghan draped over it, and my sense was I had gone to an eye doctor, and they had my afghan was draped over it, and I went to go forward, and the voice said to me, "How is your vision?" Now, that represents to me prophetic. What am I seeing? And then the second thing that the Lord reminded me is, who did you see that reminded you of the Lord? The person that said, "How is your vision?" was a person that I know that represented in this dream the Lord because of their gifting and who they are in the church. And then I woke up and I remembered both of these dreams. So, you know, they'll always say, well, if you have a dream, write it down because you won't remember it. As I said before in one of the other videos, if it's a dream from God, you will remember it. But if there is a dream that could flash by, you probably do want to write it down and see, check yourself, your own spirit. What is your own spirit trying to say to you? Is there some kind of direction that you need to take? It might not actually be, because your own spirit, the Holy Spirit is inside of you. And your own spirit man can also talk to you and say, something's a little wrong here. You need a little bit of, it's kind of like, an auto mechanic. And it's like an auto mechanic's living inside of your vehicle, and you are the vehicle. And sometimes you need a little bit of a tune-up. You don't need a whole prophetic dream to come out of it, but it's like there are some people that actually have a gifting. It's kind of like a mechanic of souls. But if you're not a good mechanic and you're seeing a soul in distress, and you aren't taking care of your own machinery, your own gears, you have everything oiled, the oil of the Holy Spirit, the watering of the Word. If you don't have these things in place, then your own spirit man could tell you, look at this, you need more of this. We need balance. If you don't have balance, then how are you going to help other people? And be careful not to, I minister in prophetic on a very low basis and not all the time, but be careful that, oh yeah, that was the other thing. Be careful that you're not giving your own opinion, because you'll give a word and then you'll give your own opinion about how they should fix it or what they should do about it. No, just say what it is you heard, tell them what it is you saw, and not another thing, because they're going to come back to you and they're going to go, well, what do you think I should do? Say, go to the Lord and pray. You go to the Lord and pray, or you go to your pastor and counsel with them, or whoever it is that you trust, because someone at that point, you're just going through a line, or you're coming in, with a ministry team work dealing in the prophetic, I remember a couple times giving my own opinion. Not a good idea. What if they take it? And it's not God. Not everything a prophet or a prophetic person says is from God. Something's trying to jog here about opinion. Prophecy is not your opinion. If you have a word for someone, give the word and don't go back to find out what they do about it. Did they obey it? Did they not? It's none of our business, I don't believe. You can give the direction to a church, then you leave the decision with them. God knows that you did what you were supposed to do. He asked you to do something. And at that point, you let it go. The enemy will, at that point, try to attack you or the people you gave the message to, because the enemy knows that it wants to disrupt what was said. He will do anything he can. Make sure you have a covering and then let God. You can make all the conditions you want under cover of what it is that you're trying to say or feel that you are a spokesman for the Lord, but the enemy can get in there and hurt feelings. If they do, pay it no, never mind. At that point, it's up to them to deal with it, to do the right thing, to go to the Lord. But anyway, this message is coming to a close. I want to make sure I pray with whoever needs prayer. So I just lift up everyone that is watching this video tonight, saved or unsaved, lost, wanting to go into ministry, not knowing what to do, feeling hurt, feeling abandoned, feeling disillusioned, feeling disappointed. I just cover them now with the oil of gladness. And I pray God's anointing into their life. There's anyone out there has not accepted Christ or has backslidden? Please say this prayer with me. Jesus, I come to you now because your word says that you are the Son of God and that you are God, and that if I confess my sins to you, you will forgive me. And you will come into my heart and into my life and give me eternal life. And that I will get to be with you from now on. That you will help me to grow. I now ask, Father, that you make them hungry for your word. Lord, that you get them to a church where they can grow and learn of you and have the word in them. Lord, that they will know what their calling is, because the people around them will see it. And we're all going to cheer now because all the angels in heaven are clapping and celebrating because another life or lives have come into the kingdom today through this video. This video could be 50 years old and go in through the tribulation, and someone's going to hear it and they're going to go, oh, I'm not going to take the mark. I'm not going to take the mark. I'd rather be beheaded. Praise God. Whatever this video is, Lord, I pray an anointing on it, Father, an anointing on anyone who hears it. I speak to the ears and the eyes to spiritually open now in Jesus' name. We give God all the glory. I'm Pamela Gunderson. I'm Pamela Gunderson Talks on You in Him Ministries. And my telephone number will be coming up at the end of this video. Have a wonderful day in the Lord, and thank you so much for giving me time to speak. Amen.
Your face is all I seek. For when your eyes child, your love abounds.